You can see the Bitly link for the slides. It'll be on the last slide as well. I believe these are the demonstrations and slides. Be on the last slide as well. So, namaste, welcome. And so before we really get started on the content, we're going to introduce ourselves and get some of the first.
Yes, can you hear me? My name is Joseph Tavernik. I'm Basio in the Drupal community. I actually started using Drupal in Central America in Nicaragua. That's one of the reasons why I'm really passionate about traveling and getting to meet a lot of different people from different communities in Drupal. I work as Deputy Head of Technology at Amazing Labs. We're in Switzerland, in Cape Town, and in Austin, Texas. Altogether 30 people, very passionate about Drupal 8, have launched our 9th Drupal 8 site already. I'm really glad to be here, and I'm also a lead of the DN Rules Initiative, so if you're interested in porting the rules module to Drupal 8, join us on Sunday for this course.
And my name is Adam Duran. I work for Forum One, which is based in Alexandria, Virginia, very close to Washington, D.C. Which is actually where I'm from originally, but I live now in Cologne, Germany. And Forum One has offices in D.C. and Seattle, Washington. Very excited about an official office in Germany as well, which I'm very excited about. I'm a senior front-end developer. I've been working in web since 1998. I've done everything from logos to schema design, and only Drupal since 2009. How many of you were at the keynote yesterday morning? Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome. I'm one of the three idiots right in the keynote, and thank you guys for coming. We had so much fun. And when I'm not speaking at DrupalCon, my passions, I'm also an opera singer, and I'm a student of Shaolin. So we also wanted to find out, who are you? Who we have in the room. So, can I say the show? Yeah? Have you tried turning off? No. Anyway, so, raise your hand if you're a site builder. Excellent. Yeah. But if you're a front-end developer?
Show me hands for the back-end developers. Is there any project managers in the room?
Well, raise both hands, we do everything. Okay, good. Good to have you.
Yeah, so while discussing coding versus clicking, basically when we work with Drupal and we have to explain other developers what Drupal is really about, a lot of the work we do with Drupal is site building or actual doing configuration via the interface. And all these different, like the front end, the back end, it really blends together, so it's a bit hard to really, really differentiate. Some of you might be more passionate about implementing everything in code, so who of you prefers coding over clicking? And who of you loves the flexibility that Drupal provides by installing additional modules and being able to click together everything? So almost balanced. Today we're going to talk about how Drupal 7 and Drupal 8 are different in those approaches when it comes to implementing layouts. And you should your time.
And as you can see, that you know the back end. Well, say more about that.
Well. You can accomplish backend tasks as a site builder. It's kind of like I'm not really convinced with the graphic yet. At least we see that there's coding, there's clicking, and everything is based on the backend.
So first, Joseph's going to talk about the coding approach.
Right. So. As a coder, I really like to be in control of everything. Drupal is already a heavy framework where I can leverage a lot of functionality, but when I'm just configuring via the user interface, it's a bit unclear for me what will really happen. With the features module and with CMI, it's a bit easier for us already because we can push what has been done through the user interface into code, but still being in full control over the markup that we create, especially for layouts, that's why I prefer to be a coder. So for coding in terms of front-end with Drupal 8, we don't need to be using PHP anymore. And that's awesome because we can produce much more beautiful templates using the Twig engine. So that's really a big win for the coders in Drupal 8. So to summarize, those of us who want to implement layouts in code, we want to have the full control. We don't want to really touch PHP, and that's maybe the differentiation that we had before. So a front-end developer is more can be more about writing templates and doesn't necessarily have to touch PHP, whereas the back-end developer obviously touches PHP in Drupal. And being happy about the Twig engine.
So then there's also the clicking approach using GUI. So you get to click all the things, we can control things, whether it's through display suite or panels or locks or custom locks now in Drupal 8. And there's so much you can do without even touching code and required in the features. So to summarize all that, so we can manage field display via back end, whether primarily using display suite. You can find layouts in the back end using the layout plugin. You control markup. There's a block attribute module. It's not quite a module yet, but it's going to be coming where you can add YAML configuration and put in extra classes for a block. It serves as a very similar function to clean markup. Camel's context allows you to rule the world in that you can have a node page, and if for a given node you have a term reference, and then you can have a content box of specifically that of content that relates specifically to that term. It's a little convoluted, but there's so much that's possible just through click.
Yeah, I think it's kind of funny because you say, well, but configuration through the user interface is not really developing something. The tools that we have at hand with Drupal, like for example the rules module or the panels context system, they really allow site builders to be creating systems, like treat the value objects that are available as objects, derive other properties from them. So the two things really blend together.
So we're going to cover four basic examples during the course of the session. We're going to look at a very simple content layout, a landing page, maybe something more complicated layout, what we're going to call a default layout with variations, which we'll do later, and how to embed additional content to a node. Additional content meaning something that is not just the fields contained in that content layout.
Cool. So we have created a simple demo page, actually two, because the session has been evolving over the last half a year and we've been adding additional functionality to it. So what we can see here is just a simple node like community members. For example, here we can see Lewis Nyman, and we can see some basic information about him. And when we talk about layouts, what is special about this page is that obviously it has a two-column layout. So how can we accomplish that? If I were the coder, I would just implement a Twig template and structure the markup so that I have two different regions or div wrappers, and there I can just put in the fields required, which is kind of it.
And in display suite, it's very similar. You can just scroll down, select your two-column layout from the bottom, hit save, and then you have a left and right column, drag and drop, and you have your five fields in your left column, your one field in your right column, click save, done.
So to recap, when we compare between Drupal 7 and Drupal 8, in Drupal 7, where, when you were a coder, you were implementing PHP templates. And instead of that, now you use a Twig template, as we have just seen.
And in Twig, you were using either a display suite or panels to create a compound layout in the display suite. And some of the new names, we say, those of you, who's the layer of Drupal 8? Who's the layer so far? All right. One thing you'll notice is that you do have view modes now in core, but they're not super powerful. In that you can't add layouts. Oh, thank you. You can't add layouts to them. If you wanted to create, you had your full content view mode like we had here. You wanted to have two columns like we had here. That's not possible out of the box in core. You have to add. I really shouldn't change that to the wrong version.
Just a bit.
Anyways, display suite allows you to add multiple columns. It also gives you actual control over the field title and where that shows up in order. You might not want the title to be the first field in your server.
Cool. So that. Oh, yes,
I continue. So now we're on a landing page, which actually has two slides. Well, that is better, isn't it? It has two slides, and over the top we have one view, a view of all of our sprinters. And then the second view, we have a list, another view of various initiatives, Frederick United, Parks Initiative, and D8 Rules. And so, this is a. So, what we would, 6 months ago when we were first creating this, you would have to. This is before the space we had reached this level of maturity that it is now, and you would have to, in YAML, create layouts, and then you can access them in your display suite. Now, the display suite, you can just click save. Like the process I described earlier, and you can just page manager. So anyway, that layout, was for page manager, but with the layout plugin and the panels module now ready, you can actually do this using panels and not a block layout page, and that gives you control of the layout through the GUI and not even having to deal with the code. So there.
So yeah, if I were to implement the landing page in code, first I need to get the data ready. Which week we are not allowed to execute any PHP functions, which is good, because maybe somebody of you has seen complex templates that implement a lot of logic on their own and do database statements and all of that sorts. In terms of best practice, we really don't like the front end to mess with the back end. So the data separation is now really in place with Drupal 8. So first of all, in order to be able to access the data as a coder, just implement the pre-process function. We can see here that I'm populating a number of variables. For example, I'm using the views and bad view function to get the random block of the view, and I put it into a variable. The second one. And then in the actual Twig template, I'm basically adding statements like if this variable is available, I'll put the block, and I could be adding more markup around it. Basically, so the landing page is this Twig template that just calls additional information that I've prepared in the pre-process function.
So to summarize,
Yes, as a coder, we're using pre-process, just that we use different templates again.
And in the clicking approach, in Drupal 7 we had page manager and panels, and now it's very, very similar, and the layout plugin, which was in core, will hopefully be back in core in 8.1, is part of the picture. The reason, let me actually say a little bit about that. The layout plugin is very similar functionality that was in Drupal 7 between panels and display suite. In controlling layouts. And what the layout plugin is that functionality in one place, so that, I mean, we all know, you know, do it once is a model for good code development, and that's what we're really now moving towards. So panels and displays, we both use the layout plugin in order to achieve the layout control.
I think it's kind of cool because panels was not so early ready as page manager was, for example. In Drupal 7, page manager is just a part of sequence, I think. Now it's its own module. So we could already start building landing pages with just page manager and the layout plugin. And panels has had the first release the last month. So we can already start playing with that, and Adam will show you later what it provides.
So now we'll talk a little bit about D7 versus D8 building tools. We've already spoken most about this. There are the various corollaries. D7, we have PHP template, and D8, we have Twig. Game process functions in both. The main difference, though, is that there is no markup in the Drupal 8 preprocessors. The markup belongs only in the Twig files, and as we demonstrated in the second example, you can get your content, your view content, and then embed it via a preprocess and then call it from the Twig template. But there's no way, you shouldn't be actually adding markup in a preprocess. It's not good for maintainability.
We tried to customize the markup of a menu in Drupal 7. Lucky you.
Yeah, right. So in D7 we have panels. Indeed, we have the Defender panels, we have plugin combined. Tell us a little about context versus context.
Right, so it's like two different things. The context module, we can use it for various things. Like, it's basically also like reacting on some context if it's given, and then executing actions similar to the rules module. But what we have been using context a lot for in Drupal 6 and in the early stages of Drupal 7 was to kind of define, okay, if I'm on a node type article, then I want to make these blocks available. So in order to reduce the complexity of the global block configuration, we create different contexts for each of those sections, which is kind of nice, but it's not really maintained anymore. So in Drupal 8, nobody has started porting the context module. But what is there is the context API, and that's the thing that's more similar to context of panels or ctools. So when we earlier described that you can access the data and build relationships to it, that's really like a core functionality now. It's used by page manager. So when you create a route, say node/ID, then it will automatically know that there's a node object available to you. That's awesome. It's also used by the rules module, for example. Just a bit of confusion with the contexts. In Drupal 8, expect the context API to be there, but the context module, nobody has started reporting.
And last but not least, the display suite. As we'll be showing you shortly, the UI is largely the same, the functionality is largely the same. So you can rest assured that if you've been using it, you can keep on using it.
It's actually pretty cool. Display suite was ported so early on, so it's pretty mature already. While panels has only a release in the last month, display suite already had releases half a year ago.
So now we're going to go back to the lab and continue with our examples. So we've already looked at a simple content layout and the landing page, and now we're going to look at the default layout variations. So our variation is very, very simple. Let's say that on the home page you want to have a different footer than you do on other pages. And you can see down here at the bottom, you just have the blue marks to start with the fancy footer, the green marks at the end, and we're going to show you how to do that, how that could be done. Incorrect.
So one nice feature of Twig is that you can define reusable blocks. Again, an overlapping terminology, the Drupal terminology, but the Twig blocks themselves are just like sections of the template that then can get reused or overridden in overriding templates. So I'm just placing the block footer wrapper around the markup that my filter already has. And then I'm creating a sub-template. So based on the generic page template, I just specify that I'm gonna extend the generic page template. And one big issue of having a lot of templates in Drupal 7 was that there was a lot of code duplication. So you copy a big template and then you adapt two lines of code, and whenever you have to adapt something else, then you have to go through all the templates and make sure that what I wanted to adapt is still valid across all of those templates. So that's like very error prone. It's not it doesn't follow the don't repeat yourself principle. So the exciting thing here is that I just declare, okay, this template is going to extend the page template. And then the only thing that I specify is what I want to override. So all the markup will be output by the base template, but then what I'm overriding is the actual footer. And in this case, we're just adding like a fancy start and the end. And we can also use the parent. So there's the parent directive that will just output the same block itself. And by that, we are basically able to wrap content as we have seen in the image. Right, so that's how you do it in coding, and how do you do it in checking?
So this is the sad part. There's actually not a good way using the UI to get that same thing. You can, in a theoretical sense, use display scooter panels, but then you're having, or panels, for example, you can have a different variant for the front page, but then you have two instances where you're placing all of your content on the front page let's assume that you have one variant for all of your nodes, front page and everything else. Silly, because front pages are always special, but let's just pretend. You would have to have one variant which had pieces of content, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then the footer, that would be the home page, and then your other variant which had pieces of content, 1, 2, 3, 4, and if you needed to remove pieces of content 2, you'd have to do it in both places. Now, is this that much work? No, but in a theoretical sense, if we're trying to, do it, have your code in one spot, then it's not the best solution. In this case, using the extending twig is a better solution.
Maybe you could do something with mini panels, but I think that's not part of it.
Finally, number four, or actually not the last one, it's a special bonus one. Embed additional content. This is a node page for a given initiative, in this case Front End United, which has the node content on the left. On the right is the associated people who are sprinting on that initiative. And you could use the core block system to drop this in there, but as you guys all know from Drupal 7, if you're using core blocks to place content for a large site, that page is long. And that's just a really messy way to deal with it. And so instead, we're going to do something else. We're going to use a DS block field. So this is in display suite, add block field, and I can't spell it. Block field, remove the nodes, no limit, or block field. So you can take any block that exists, literally anything. I have block field, and now in a given view mode, which is a node, say I want to go to display my full content. Has block field. And I can now move this into content. actually visit a node. This is the login form. Boom. So that can be done in Display Suite. It can also be done in panels, actually, which I'll show you another example of in just a moment. So in this particular case, we use the block field to position the initiative sprinters in the right column, as you can see, or as you saw in the example here. And so that's how it would work in clicking.
Yeah, for decoders, it's basically the same procedure as I've presented before. If we would want to add additional information, again, implement the pre-process function and add it to the template. That's not really changing much.
So, quick review.
As coders, to add additional content, we can invoke the blocks or the views from our templates in Drupal 7. In Drupal 8, we use the pre-process.
And for clicking in Drupal 7, we had your general blocks, EVA, which is Entity View Attachment, ES Dynamic Fields, or Panels, and in Drupal 8, we're embedding additional content. We have the new ES Block Fields, and then the ever-famous Page Manager Panels Layout plugin combination. Now, we're going to look at something new, and I'm going to introduce this quickly. There's a current trend in content called long-form content, and this is, at least in the United States right now, how many have you heard of long-form content? Okay. In the United States, newspapers are using this a lot, the New York Times, Washington Post, and it is basically, it has these layers or strata of content, a paragraph, a picture, three items, featured items, and these pages tend to be longer, but the density of the content tends to be slightly less and scrollable. And so I recommend you might want to check it out. And it won't be the home pages of these websites, it'll be the individual articles. Sometimes you'll find these long form content. You can also Google it. Unfortunately, for us, there is a module now in Drupal. I think it was for Drupal 7 as well. It's also already ported to Drupal 8, and Joseph is going to demonstrate some of that.
Actually, we also started doing the homepage in paragraphs. Amazing, we don't use paragraphs in Drupal 7 because it has some issues with multilingual. But for Drupal 8, paragraphs really worked well. And I just set up here on the demo site, the paragraphs demo. Actually, you can just when you download the paragraphs module, there's also a demo submodule that will allow you to already have a couple of paragraphs predefined. So what we can see here is like a standard node with some introduction text, and then we have different sections. So for example, one section has the image on the left, and then the description. The other section has the text on the left and then some text.
Can you go into the admin and then maybe add another layer or two, other types of content?
So when I'm editing the node itself as a content editor, I think the main difference here is that we don't use a WYSIWYG to create like very long sections, but we structure the way that the content editor works in a better way. So they have a lot more flexibility because they can add the sections that have been predefined, and they kind of have like different templates. So we can see add image and text, or add text and image, add just text, add a number of images. And then this will get added to the form, and then the editor uploads a funny image. Because we've been dealing with messy WYSIWYG too often, and this way we can ensure that the structure of the markup is the way that we want to have it.
kind of see how these lay out of the box. So, I mean, you can very easily theme these and have them be in a row, but it's about dropping the content into a given section. It gives the content manager more control. It's actually incredibly difficult for content managers. If they're dealing with one WYSIWYG and trying, it never looks quite right, and WYSIWYG, it frustrates them, and they do one thing, and it doesn't come out the same way on the page, and then they bother you, and no one wants that.
Anyone familiar with the field collection model? Okay, so paragraphs is basically a fork of the field collection model, and so we have seen now how the editing works, and when I go back into the back end, I can see that I have different paragraph types. So it's like load types, but specifically for the paragraphs, and they really work the same. It's just like they are attached to loads, they don't live on their own in the system. But we can see that for any of these given paragraph types, we can add additional fields. So we can really, in a more granular way, define the blocks of information that the content editors then can use. And on the other hand side, we can benefit from like managed display and have the information first structured and then output it the right way as a front-end developer.
You have a question, sir?
Paragraph is a problem with like field collection or not anymore. So in field collection, it gets breaks and then
Anymore. Correct. In Drupal 7, it has the same problem, but in Drupal 8, there's an open issue for paragraphs in Drupal 7 for multilingual. But some colleagues have told me that they found workarounds to it, so you can also try it. We decided to not use it in Drupal 7, but for Drupal 8, we're already using it on multilingual websites, and it works fine.
So, actually, before we talk about deployment, yes, I'm actually going to show you, a little more. So I'm working on a chapter for a book that's called Drupal 8 Blueprints. It should come out in May. And the chapter that I'm writing is on how to build a classified listing directory site. And so what I've built here, I'm just going to talk really quickly through this because there's a lot of site building aspects and that I've used here almost entirely through the UI, which is amazing. So here, on the homepage, we have feature classifiers, there's three of them. Now this is also something that's new in Drupal 8. It's called custom block types. I'm going to demonstrate that right now. So if you go to block layout, you see custom block library. And I have two types of custom blocks. You can create blocks of any type. What I'm about to demonstrate is it's an entity reference block. It's feature classifies. You don't have to create a view for this anymore. You just create, I created this, or I'm actually gonna go back and create the block type again so that you can see that process. Add a custom block type. Test type. This is the content. And I can limit them to a certain type. I'm just like I had before, I'm limited to the classified add type, not from the sort. Pretty simple. Now, go back here. Now I'm going to add another custom block of the test type. And then you can see down here, I can add, must have made a mistake when I created it. Let's go back and look at this one. Then. This is when I already. Let me take another instance of my official classifieds. Pull up any of the classified ad content types. Save. So I have this, and I can go position this anywhere. Move up on my home page. This is the page manager interface. I have variants here. And one of the things that differentiates a panel page versus a block page is this right here, that it gives you control over the layout. You have all these layouts you can choose from. One thing which is not fully fleshed out is if you change the layout, you say you go from a one-column layout to a three-column layout, there's no invitation to move the content from the one column into any of the other columns. Let's find out what it defaults to. Let's see. We'll see if it puts it in the first column. My bad. Yeah, puts it in the first column. So I'm going to add a new block. This one right there. Title. Now you can see, jam that in there, and it has this one in here, and I could have put something in the right column, but didn't. So that, let's go to also Display Suite. I'll show you the display for classified ads. I didn't do any of these in any complicated layouts. Just reset here. But let's say in the full content I wanted to put things into two columns. Do that for save for that little hole. Oh, here we have the panels doesn't have this yet. We'll hopefully they will soon. Main content and left. I'm just going to put my test block field up on the right. Save. Save. Now whenever you want to view a given node, I have a login, which is our test block on the right. So, you guys have any questions about the new GUI at this point? Let's start with you. Sorry, one more time.
So the custom type that you have mentioned is actually, I'm able to see that it is actually having similar structures we have in the
ADP. Okay.
Yeah, actually, that's the way we built sites before we knew that entity queue was available. So we had pages that were referencing different blocks in order to be able to position blocks in a specific order.
Is there a version of Entity for Drupal already?
Yes.
I mean, so just like Drupal 7, there are many ways to get there. They're very, just like there's some solutions for clicking, some for clicking. You can use Entity Queue, you can use the custom block type. It ultimately comes down to, and we're going to discuss this right at the very end, what you and your team agree on, what you prefer. There are going to be pros and cons of every approach. So
I think it comes down to Entity Queue provides additional functionality in terms of having a limit and automatically adding and removing items. And this would be like a manual approach. But if the manual approach suffices your requirements, it's perfectly valid to not depend on an additional module and just implement it with Drupal core, which will be easier to maintain in the long term.
More questions about the stuff on the temperature? Yes, sir.
When you work in different environments, how the logs works in the videos?
In deploying, the
logs. I'm
fairly certain that almost everything gets turned into.
So we have to differentiate between configuration and content and the block. So when we go into the UI here. Of the structure block layout. What is configuration is definitely the different block types, for example. So when I go into types, everything that Adam has configured as different block types, those are configuration and those are easily deployable. But the actual instances, when I add a custom block, that to the system is content. So it's not supported by CMI to be exported. You would need another, like the deploy module, but I haven't tried that yet.
So there are two kind of blocks.
And when it gets interesting, when you build a landing page with panels or page manager, because the landing page itself is configuration, and then it adds instances of block content. What it does there is that when you deploy the CMI configuration, it will just create empty placeholders for that content that you refer to with the same URL, but it does not deploy the content for you.
And we have a question over there. Let's get your microphone.
So that's been a very good session. Especially because once Drupal 8 has come, the question always arises of all the panels can be Drupal 8. So I have two questions basically. Can you give classes to content panes in Drupal 8?
Yes, you can. It's not a module yet, but there is stuff on GitHub. I can find the URL for you. How you mind showing me this? So block attributes, and what it allows you to do is through YAML. Yeah, here it is. YAML configuration. You can add attributes to any block. This is very similar. I mentioned this earlier. It's very similar to clean markup blocks, clean markup panels. As a front end developer, this is something that I rely on a lot because I don't like using pane. Display blah blah blah, a bunch of like numbers and letters. I want to actually have semantic naming in my themes. So this will allow you to do just exactly that. Let's say you have a block, you can create a block dash dash my special block, call it whatever you want, and then this is also it shows it's part of the block wrapper, and I assume therefore part of configuration. And will when you deploy, it will also move up. Does that answer your question, sir?
Yes.
You can edit this configuration from the GUI, I believe, but I have not yet tried it yet. It's
okay.
I personally
have tried it and sort of missing panels right now. One more question, paragraphs, just like you mentioned, is a brilliant new invention, I would say, in Drupal. Like you can go on and on and on and add content into it. Just your skills of reading paragraph types is the main thing. But entity view mode selector, the module that you have had the name of.
Entity view mode selector? No, I'm not familiar.
Okay. That comes handy while you are adding a particular paragraph item.
Yes.
And you choose a view mode.
I see exactly what you're talking about.
That module is also in dev right now, particularly.
Thank you. That's I've been looking for that entity view mode selector.
So that was sort of, according to me, a missing point in the presentation. That's a brilliant one if you can install it. having Paragraph ideas. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Nice.
Actually was also the question about the deployment. Let this up and see if we have more questions.
Yes. We're going to have more questions in a minute. We're just going to talk through what we've already covered, and then we have lots of time for questions. So we're just going to quickly review what we've learned so far. Encoding versus clicking. Each has its strengths and its weaknesses. I think we can see that neither approach is the best for our situation. And what that means is that it really depends on who you're working with and what their preferences are, what your preferences are. There's a lot of people to consider. I think many of you do many, many, wear many hats. And you might have, some of you have a stronger front-end approach, some of you have a stronger clicking approach, and you have to just work with your team members and decide how you as a group are going to tackle a given project. Because ultimately, if you're clashing with your teammates and you do it one way and they want to do it another way, that gets messy. You should plan ahead of time and ideally across projects have the same strategy. It's worthwhile taking some time and figuring out a group-wide approach. So the bottom line is that there is more than one way to skin a cat, and the cat doesn't like that one. And like I just said, teamwork, it gets stuff done. I like this line. So it comes down to coding and clicking. There's no one approach. You can't do site building entirely from create and entry process. And you can't do it entirely from the GUI. You need both.
So the good news is that for people with Drupal 7 experience, much of your knowledge is still relevant. Most of the modules are there. Like we have seen that the context module is not available. But if you're familiar with display suite or the pandas ecosystem, you will find the same stuff in Drupal and Drupal 8.
And there's also lots to new information to learn. All of these great syntax. There's lots of extra different things you can do, more advanced. You can filter content that's coming in. It's much easier to access things in an object, array chain, etc. This is not a discussion, but those of you who know a little bit about Twig, it's incredibly powerful as a templating engine. There's the YAML syntax, which we had when showing the block attributes, and then a few other examples, which is a new thing for all of us. And blocks, custom block types, and so on, a lot more powerful in a lot of different ways. So the good news is you don't have to throw the baby out in the bathwater. This is an English expression. Do you guys know this expression? That's just creative about that. And so we learned a lot. And now we have 10 more minutes for questions. So first question.
Session, Joseph and Adam. So my question is that you said that we can figure out, set the layout using the GUI of Drupal. And Drupal 8 core is in itself responsive. So is the layout plugin is responsive in Drupal 8?
The layouts themselves are probably not necessarily responsive. They're probably just a fixed set. They probably do not have breakpoints included. You're also a front-ender?
Yeah.
Are you familiar with the Singularity library?
I didn't get it.
What? Singularity. Singularity is a library that allows you to create and code.
Similar to SUSE, a grid framework?
Yeah. But yes, it is. It is a grid framework that you can create your own layouts and breakpoints. At Forum 1, we have a library of these layouts. Left sidebar, right sidebar, all sorts of different layouts. I can show you on my laptop.
I think we can use SUSE and other frameworks to create our own custom layouts and incorporate them to make them responsive.
And if you put them in the right spot in the architecture, you can access them in panels, in displays where you can access them anywhere. And then you have content that, as you're building your site, is responsive.
Yeah, so the layout by itself is just a definition of which regions there are, and then it can attach CSS. The good thing is that the layouts can also be defined by a theme. So if you, because with all the new grid frameworks, you don't want to have the layout split up too wide, because then you cannot depend on the same SAS variables, for example. So my suggestion is that the layout itself just defines the structure, and your theme puts on the responsive layout on top of that.
Thank you.
More questions? Come on, one more? Anyone?
What's the biggest pain point with layouts in Drupal for you?
Or biggest pain point in layouts in general?
They roll much smarter. In Drupal, they used to roll much smarter.
Too much marker.
Right? Yes.
So maybe to follow up on the too much markup.
Hello, sir.
Let's just a quick follow up on that. The good thing about Drupal 8 is that everything is controlled via templates. So you will find a lot more possibilities to make the markup cleaner, and also there has already been a lot of efforts in Drupal 8 to make the markup less than required. So, and there's also the cloud, like there's a new, probably it was mentioned in another front-end session, so that the way that the theming system is built in Drupal 8, you can have templates with as little markup as needed, and you can have the classy templates that will provide a bit more verbose markup in order to be able to target more. So it's, baseline is much better.
Talking about the banana conversation.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Banana. The banana craziness.
Yes, sir.
Well, first of all, lovely session.
Thank you.
And another thing that, thank you for telling me something that Drupal is more of something that is controlled by template. Okay. Sir, I'm with the background of just web designer and who's new to Drupal 8, who does not know about Drupal 7 at all. Okay. What I'm trying to know is how much it is flexible to the graphics. Like, you know, we deliver, we cut slices in Photoshop, and then we try to code it, and we try to, you know, make a good website altogether. So how much flexible it is in that case?
I think that depends on your approach in your design department. I'm gonna use this one. I think it depends on how well the front-end developers and the designers can communicate. At Forum One, I work very heavily with my designer and UX person, the person creating the wireframes, to think in components. To that end, we use a tool called Pattern Lab, where things are broken down into atoms. Atoms comprise molecules, comprise view modes or layouts, comprise pages. And so that I'm really working with the designer, I want a whole PSD, but I also want them to see that what they have here, this is an atom. This is the search bar, for example, has two atoms. It has the text field and it has the button. And that in itself is a molecule. And I want to even theme that in a way that exists. That same markup will look when I have, you know, in a sidebar, it'll look this small. And then when it's across the top of a large page, it'll fill up the space. And I want the CSS to do that out of the box. I don't want to have separate CSS. Because the structure should be the same, and it should expand to fill the space. But you have to, it takes time to build a relationship with your design team, to have them to start to think like this is a paradigm shift for them. If they're used to just, sorry, I'm running inside of the room. If your design team's used to just spitting out these beautiful designs but aren't thinking about how it lays out, you as a front-ender have to be the nice police and help them learn how to start to think more in components. Because it helps everyone ultimately. Otherwise, you're just trying to, it gets messy.
You're saying that web components are far more important than designing anything.
I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying that it's important. Ultimately, websites exist, in my estimation, to deliver content, no matter how it looks. And to that end, users want to get to a website that it's great if it's pretty, and it needs to be pretty. It's marketing and branding, that's all very important. But if the user cannot find what they're looking for quickly, they will leave your website. And so, it's good to be creative, and it's good to be innovative, but sometimes to be bleeding edge in a design, I think you can shoot yourself in the foot. That said, it's also possible, no matter what the design, to find a structure that works. Any design is capable. I've had to do some tough stuff, and it's. So does that answer your question? I mean, I think it's fuzzy. I think there's no real hard and fast answer to how do you cut up a page. You know, that's a whole different thing.
I like referring to the term design systems. Like we don't just create websites, but underlying there's a content management system, there's a framework. So also the design in the end should follow a systematic approach in order to not work with hacks on every single page, but to like start from usable, like the molecules, the atoms, and all that kind of metaphors help us to communicate, create something that follows like patterns and makes it more concise, and also in the end, more usable for the end user.
And that's one of the strong advantages of using as a front ender something like Pattern Lab, because it helps you work browser, you work in pair with your designer, and you help them see how things are structured in a more structured library way. And I think ultimately it results in cleaner looking websites, especially when you're dealing with large quantities of content and many, many types of content. So any more questions? Oh, yes, ma'am.
This is our last question.
Hello. So I'm working on a Drupal 8 project right now. So I had to make a custom form for my customer. Thing was that I want to ask you a question that creating a quick file for that custom form overrides my custom theme, right?
Say that one more time.
I am having a custom form. If I make a quick file for my custom form, then it overrides all the functionalities of my custom themes, right? If you need to get the functionality of a system, you have to render it through your quick files. So what approach do I have to follow for this thing?
What are you trying to accomplish?
Okay, I have a custom form. I need to...
Like a contact form, you said?
A custom form. Okay. A simple custom form.
Any form, yeah.
Any form, right. And if I want to theme it according to my customer, I need to have a template file for that to give them div, CSS, or any styling. Which approach should I follow? Just introduce all those divs, CSS classes within my controller or my form, or use a template grid?
So if the CSS is sufficient, then I would try to not adapt the markup at all. But if you have to adapt the markup, then implementing a template for that form.
Okay, because if I implement it with a tweak, it will override all my custom template and all my functionalities of forms.
So you want to target this specific form and not all the other forms,
because,
right?
Because it makes the code a bit, a bad coding system if I introduce all those in classes and styling in my custom.
Okay, sure.
My instinct and would be to use Twig and extend the general form template, and using the Twig's template suggestions, figure out what you need to name it so that it targets that, and then add an additional class into the top level form or HTML element or the top level div. And then have let everything cascade.
It's a lot of overhead in Drupal 8 when you take suggestions for any quick template file for any custom pages or forms. It overrides all your things.
Usually, it depends on the specificity of the template that you implement. There could be a general form template, but then using the suggestion system, it also allows you to implement specific templates for specific form types or for specific form instances. So you can enable the Twig debug system, and then it will tell you which of the templates you can implement. And if you don't have a specific suggestion available, you can also implement a hook to add your own custom suggestions.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. So we want to thank you all for attending. If you all would be so kind, you can see there's a Bitly link for the evaluation. It takes you to our session page. And it would be great if you would go and write nice things about us. And
tell us the truth.
Or tell us the truth. Or you better tell us the truth. Tell us the truth. And the slides, as you can see, are still available at Bitly Asia layout slides. And please stay in touch, reach out. Here's Yosef's information, and here's mine. And really thank you all for your time and attention. And hope you have a great rest of your DrupalCon. Thank you.